Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Great to see everyone here this morning as we worship. I want to welcome our online audience as well. It's great to be in the Lord's house this morning to be able to worship. We're in this series we're calling Conquering the Giants of Our Life. And we're going to pick up a new giant here this morning. We talked about fear so far, finances, and then today we're going to talk about career, our job stresses. And so we'll be doing that here this morning. Just want to bring the attention to a few announcements. Please don't forget, in the back of the auditorium is some sign-up sheets. The ones I wanted to bring your attention to this morning is there's a sign-up sheet for the blood drive is coming up on May 5th. That's in your bulletin. If you can give blood, we appreciate it if you sign up on that. We're trying to get, I think, 12 sign up on that. If you can help us with that, we appreciate that. It's coming up May 5th. It'll be 5 days here at the building in our parking lot. Also, for Mother's Day this year, we're going to do a brunch on May 8th at 10 o'clock. And this is for all the ladies of the church. And so in the back is a sign-up sheet for that as well. We'll ask you to put your name, your phone number, and then if you have any food allergies that we need to be aware of for the meal, we appreciate that as well. So there's a sign-up sheet for that. Ladies, come and be a part of that on May 8th at 10 o'clock. Also, National Day of Prayer event, the Ministry Alliance is hosting that again. That's coming up on May 6th. It's going to be in Bridge City at the park. So if you can be a part of that, we'll meet at 11:30 there in Bridge City for the National Day of Prayer. And one last thing is the Tommy Wolf concert's coming up this Thursday night. There's a little advertisement for it inside your bulletin. So we started inviting you to come and be a part of that. He does comedy. He's going to sing for us. And he also is going to bring us a message about serving others. And then he travels quite a bit. I think he's on tour right now. I'm not for sure, but I think the last thing I saw was Sidewalk Prophets. But he's been on tour with Mercy Me, David Crowder, a bunch of different. I put a list in the e-newsletter telling you all the places he's been. But come and be a part of that. Invite your friends to come. Be just a night of faith and family. It's coming up on Thursday night at 6:30 at the building. Any other announcements you need to make here this morning? Am I forgetting anything? All right. How about any anniversaries this week? Birthdays? Yes? Elaine. So she's not in the room, so you can tell us how old she is, huh? You're not going to go there?
You probably don't know.
68? All right. I thought you were attending like 108. No, 68. My mother's but 68, great. How about any others? Any other birthdays? Even though she's not in the room, we're going to go ahead and sing to her, okay? You can tell we sing. Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
We're going to begin this morning by singing Great is the Lord, and we'd like to begin our worship this morning by reading together Psalm chapter 145, verse 3. Let's read that together. It says, Great is the Lord, and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. Let's sing together.
Faithful and true, Christ mercy.
Father, it's so great to be able to gather in your house this morning, both in this building, and Father, as well as we gather here online today. Father, it is great to be able to gather and to worship you and praise you and give you the honor that your name deserves so much. One day, we're all going to be standing, hopefully with a great multitude, as it says in Revelation, as we stand together and we worship, and there will be people from every nation, every race, of every people of this earth gathering together to worship. And we just pray today that everything we say, everything we do, we bring honor and worth to your most precious and holy name. We pray all these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated as we... We're going to continue our worship this morning. I'm singing Because He Lives, and there's a reason we gather this morning. The reason our church gathered this morning was to remember that Jesus is alive. Sing with me.
Thank you.
to sing a new song for us. We haven't done it in worship yet, and it has a song by Chris Harmon called Jesus. And we'll use this song to focus ourselves as we come to this time of prayer this morning. If you're online, you can submit your prayer request with us this morning. And if, in the audience, I've got a couple cards, but if you have some others, we'll take those after we sing. Sing with me, Jesus.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation. Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the dark.
This morning, Gary Cornell, he has congestive heart failure. Kathy gave me that this morning, so let's remember Gary. Also, have a praise from Amanda. We were praying for her last week. Her ultrasound was normal. She had a reaction to the COVID shot, which was causing swelling in her lymph nodes. So that was a great answer of prayer, a great reason to praise God this morning. Any other prayer requests for this morning? I'll make note of. I know Betty Stenick and her husband, Johnny, are in Houston this week. Johnny's for his checkup. He has cancer. And then Betty is having some problems with her heart. And so they're doing some tests this week to decide what they're going to do. Hopefully no open heart surgery, that they'll be able to do it without having to open her heart up to fix that problem with her valve. So let's pray for her and her husband this week. Any others? Yes, Carol?
I have an update on John's knee.
Okay.
The doctor gave him, put a shot in there, and there's right now we're not looking at any surgery of any kind. So that's
so
great.
So, John, you ready for a run a marathon? Yeah. That's good news, right?
Right.
No surgery. Great. Okay. Any others? Well, remember Dwight. Continue to pray for Dwight. Remember Mary and RC as well.
Anne-Marie.
Anne-Marie. She's going to this as well. Any others? Any others we need to make mention? Yes, RC?
Bob Skaggs.
He has COVID. And he's had some pneumonia issues over the years. And so we need to remember him. He's having a really difficult time with COVID. He's in the hospital. Okay. Any others?
In case they wonder, it's a guy from Kentucky.
From Kentucky. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Any others? Okay. Okay. Let's pray together. Most gracious Heavenly Father, you are a powerful God. Well, it's great to be able to study Jesus' life and see he is the one that walked on the waters. He is the one that was beside us in the fires of the life that we live through. And Father, we just pray here this morning that we cling to that and remember that Jesus walked this earth and he went through the things we went through here. And that, Father, that he lived a life that we can model our lives after and that we can strive after him. And, Father, as we gather here this morning as a corporate body to pray, we ask you to be with those that have been mentioned here. We ask you to be with the Cornells, be with Gary this morning as he has congestive heart failure. I ask you to place your hand upon him. Father, we ask you to be with those that are running tasks, be with Betty and her husband and as they look for a solution. We ask you to be with those who are fighting cancer right now, Russell's and Dwight, and I should be with Marie today and continue to be with her and strengthen her. Father, we ask you to be with those. There's so many, right, Father, that have went through COVID and fighting COVID, and we ask you to be with them and place your hands upon them. Father, we also do not want to neglect of just honoring you and praising you for the way that you answer prayers. And Father, we just are so thankful today and the news from Amanda, and there's probably others here that could give testimony of the way that you have heard our prayers and answered those prayers. And Father, we just want to praise you here today for that. Father, as we continue to worship you here, that everything we say, everything we do, would just bring honor to your name. And we pray all these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As we prepare to come around the Lord's table here this morning, we're going to sing, My Jesus, I Love Thee. And then we'll spend some time taking communion together. Let's sing together.
My gracious.
It was why he had come, but it didn't make the task any easier. He trudged the dusty highway, the heavy crossbeam grating against the raw wounds in his back. The crowd gawked, some turned their faces away, unable to look at the horror. Others jeered, a few wept. Some went about their business as if the parade of Roman soldiers surrounding a condemned man were just another part of a typical day in Jerusalem. This was no typical day, however. Other criminals had been crucified on crosses, of course, but no man like this had ever faced this punishment, nor ever would again. This was no ordinary man. This was no ordinary crucifixion. In a matter of hours, however, the world, in fact, all of eternity, would be changed forever. Countless prophecies of old would be fulfilled. Satan would be dealt a blow from which he would never recover. Death would be swallowed up in victory. Sin would be completely paid for. And access to God would be given to all who sought to love and worship him. That was why he had come, to love the unlovely, to seek the lost, and to show how much he loves us by buying us at the highest cost. There truly is no greater love than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. That's what he did for you. That's how much he loves you. So we need to bask in God's love for you. Praise him that he paid the price that your sins deserve so that you can have fellowship with him. Father in heaven, we give you thanks, Lord, that we have the opportunity to come about your table today. We pray that you would bless this cup and this local trip into your shed blood and broken body, Lord. Pray that each one remember all the things they did to you on the cross. And before they put you on the cross, Lord, it was terrible. We pray all these things in Christ Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's take the emblems together here this morning. We're going to take the bread. This represents Jesus' body. Let's take that together. And now take the cup, which represents Jesus' blood. We also gathered here this morning to worship as well through the giving of our tithes and our offerings today. And so, if you are online with us, or you're here this morning, didn't bring it with you, we still get to our website, our app. Also, you can do it through your bank, mail it here, or bring it by the church this week. So let's pray for that as we take give our tithes and offerings for this week. Let's pray, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the way that you do bless our lives. Father, today we're talking about careers and the stress of the jobs that we have. Father, we are thankful for those jobs and the jobs that we had in the past and the abilities we have for some of us to retire and some of us to just continue working. And as we do those things, Father, we come today bringing back a portion of how you have blessed us. And so today, we ask you to bless those who are able to give, those who are not able to give, but that, Father, you give us wisdom and knowledge on how to spend those funds and to use those funds for the building up of your kingdom. So we pray for those this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Gather this morning to continue this series that we began a couple weeks ago called Conquering the Giants. And during this series, we've been looking at some of the biggest giants that we face in our lives and how God can help us to overcome those giants. And we've been using the life of David in order to wrap our minds around this series of facing giants. And so last week we talked about finance, and as we think about finance, the one we're going to talk about this morning is not much below and sense of importance and things that the giants that we have in our life is this one of career stress. And I thought this morning as we began, I went to the internet and I found a list of the most stressful jobs according to a survey. And before we start, I know some of you will disagree with this list. But I thought it would be fun to start this morning by looking at what a particular survey said were the 10 most stressful jobs. Here's number 10. Number 10 is a taxi driver. being a taxi driver. We here in our area probably don't have to worry about the 2 minutes, more like an Uber driver maybe. How about number nine, senior corporate executive? Maybe so. How about public, number eight, public relations executive? They're probably under a lot of pressure about, you know, how people perceive you. Number seven, news reporter. Anybody disagree? That's a pretty stressful job, I guess. Broadcaster is number six. We get to number four, police officer. Probably, we do a news survey, that's probably even higher. I'm being a police officer today. Number three, an airline pilot. Number two, a firefighter. And number one, enlisted military personnel, especially those who have been in at least 3 to 4 years. What is interesting, I put in my notes actually what each of these make, and the number one actually makes the less amount of money than all the others that are in our list. How about what are the least stressful jobs? I put up the top five. There they are. Number one, diagnostic medical sternographer. Probably because they have to don't deal with very many people. And number five, a university professor. Especially, I guess, if you're tenured and you don't have to worry about losing your job. But here's what makes all this worse, right? Not only do many of us maybe have stressful jobs, you're probably saying, my job is not on that list this morning, you know? And you're probably thinking that, you know, it maybe did not listen, but depending on your circumstances, your job is stressful. Is your career or job, lack thereof, right now, one of the biggest giants that you're facing in your life? Be honest. You feel like you hit the ceiling in your job, that you cannot progress any further than where you are, and you can't move any further in work, then that's a giant. Or if you're bored and you're totally disinterested in what you do at work, you feel like you work and you don't make a difference at your job, and you feel like there's no real eternal impact. If so, that's a giant. Do you have a bad boss, or do you have a toxic work environment? You feel like you're not treated fairly. That people dump on you, and you don't get credit for the work that you do. If so, that's a giant. Or you feel like a failure. Your business is failing, or maybe you recently lost a job. Then that's a giant. Or are you lost? You're not sure what you're going to do for a living. You don't know what direction that you're going to go in. If so, that's a giant. Close to 9% of Americans, but close to 60% of all the people who are employed in America say they are dissatisfied and they are unhappy with their current job. And get this, 65% of all employed Americans are actively looking for a new job. Now think about that. That doesn't mean that the other 35% are happy. It just means that they're not going to quit tomorrow. And there is a lot of dissatisfaction with our careers. And I want you to understand, that is not how God really wants it to be. I'm not saying that your job is always going to be fun and it's always going to be fulfilling, but God doesn't want you to live a defeated life. He does not want that. When it comes to your career, He does not want that for you. He wants to help you overcome your career giant because God's looking out for you and He wants something better for you. If you take out your notes here this morning, look inside your bulletin and take out your notes, our message notes, because today we're going to look at the story from the life of David that's in the Old Testament. In fact, this is the very first time David appears in the Bible, and this is an interesting story. There's an interesting story because the story, David actually gets a pretty significant promotion in what he's going to do for a living, what he's going to do with the rest of his life. You're going to see that what I'm talking about as we follow along in this passage. I put the passage not on the screen, but it's in your notes here this morning. It's 1 Samuel chapter 16. Follow your notes as I read that out loud with you here this morning. It says this: Now the Lord said to Samuel, "You have mourned long enough for Saul. I have rejected him as king of Israel. So fill your flask with olive oil and go to Bethlehem. Find a man named Jesse who lives there, for I have selected one of his sons to be my king. Now stop there for just a second. Samuel is the main prophet of all of Israel. He is the one to whom God speaks to so that he can speak to the entire nation, and the prophet had the responsibility of anointing the next king. And they would take oil and they anoint the next king, and whoever they anointed, that person would be the next king. And Saul had been the king up to this point, and God had recently chosen, he had chosen Saul. He meant good at first, but then Saul got off track. And he didn't try to get back on the right track. He stayed off that track. And he still wanted to be king, even though God had rejected him. So God sends Samuel to Bethlehem. And let's look at verse 6. It says, when they arrived, Samuel took one look at Eliab and thought, surely this is the Lord's anointed. So here he goes. He looks at Jesse's sons, and the first one coming is the oldest. And he's impressive, he's strong, he's big and handsome, and this has got to be the next king, Samuel thinks to himself. Look at verse 7. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not judge by his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord doesn't see things the way that you see him. People judge by the outward appearance, but the Lord, look at it, the Lord looks at the heart. You see what God is telling Samuel? He says, look, we tried your way last time. We tried it that your way. Saul was the tallest Israelite. He was the one of the best warriors. He was strong. He was good looking. He was anointed to be the king. And what happened? It all fell apart. We're not going to do it that way anymore, what God is saying. I don't look at it like you see it, he's telling Samuel. I'm looking at the heart of Eliab. And guess what? Eliab falls short. So he continues. Verse 10. In the same way, all seven of Jesse's sons were presented to Samuel. But Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen any of these. And Samuel asked, Are these all the sons you have? They're still the youngest, Jesse replied. But he is out in the fields, watching the sheep and the goats. Send for him at once, Samuel said. We will not sit down to eat until he arrives. Now pause right there just for a second. The other son, he was thought of so lowly in the family, it's so little significance, that they didn't even think about bringing him to the house to meet Samuel. And they're thinking in their own minds probably that there's no way that David could be the next king. But Samuel says, bring him in. Look at verse 12. So Jesse sent for him. He was dark and handsome, with beautiful eyes, and the Lord said, this is the one, anoint him. So as David stood there among his brothers, Samuel took the flask of oil he had brought, anointed David with the oil, and the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David from that day on. Unfortunately, if you're facing a giant today in your career, a prophet is not coming to your house and anointing you and telling you what your new career is going to be. That's probably not going to happen today. That's probably not going to happen. That's not how it works. But from this short encounter, we can learn some pretty important biblical principles that are going to help us to conquer this career giant that we're facing. So if you look inside your message notes here this morning, and let's look at four godly choices that we need to make in order for us to conquer the giant of career success. And here's the first choice. Write this down. Choose to pursue a heart of integrity. Choose to pursue a heart of integrity. Now, God wants to use you. He has a plan for your life. He has a vision for your career. And it is the very best what he has for you. But you need to understand this. God will not use you if you lack integrity. God cannot use you if you do not have a heart of integrity. He just won't. God chooses to use people primarily from their heart. God looks past David's brothers, 1 through 7. And he did not choose any of them. Why? Because he looked at their hearts, and there was something that was lacking each of their hearts. They lacked a heart of integrity. But God chose David just for that reason. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. Go back in our story. The Lord said to Samuel, "Do not judge by appearance or height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not see things the way you see them. People judge by the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Underline that phrase. The Lord looks at the heart. In fact, if you're looking right now for a promotion, if you're looking for something significant in your life, I want you to understand that right now. God is looking at your heart. Before he can give you something more, before he can give you something better, he needs to find a heart of integrity. Before he can trust you with what you want, you have to develop a heart of integrity. Now, was David perfect? Absolutely not. Not by a long shot. In fact, next week we're going to go back. We're going to look at his life and conquering the giant of failure. And David had a lot of failures in his life. Failures as a husband, failures as a father, failures as a king. He had a lot of failures in his life. And he had a lot of failures as a human being. In spite of all that, I want you to see what God said when he looked at David's heart. Look at Acts chapter 13, verse 22 says. It says, God removed Saul and replaced him with David. And look what it says. A man about whom God said, I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. Will you underline that phrase, a man after my own heart? In other words, David, he has a heart like mine, God says. He will do everything I want him to do. He will do what I ask him to do. He will follow me. He will pursue me with passion. You see, David was a man after God's heart. He had a passion for the things of God. He wanted to please God with his life desperately. He wanted to do what God wanted him to do. Now understand that there are two types of Christians in the world. One pays lip service to following Jesus. They come to church on Sunday, but during the week, they live a life that is completely different than that. They live like everyone else. They live their life no differently than anyone else. They're not pursuing God. They lack. They have this lackluster faith. They're not pursuing God with their heart. But the other Christian, they're the ones that go after God full throttle. They go full throttle after what God wants. They want to please God. Now, does this Christian mess up with sin? Yes. But when they sin, they're broken about it. They're broken by their sin. They hate it when they fall short. They repent. They turn around. They follow God. They ask for forgiveness. And then they start following God with all their heart again. See, that's someone who's a man after or a woman after God's heart. And that was David. Let me ask you this. What type of Christian are you? Are you a woman or a man after God's heart? Are you that? See, you pursue God. You want to please God in everything you do. Or do you have a lackluster faith? You're here on Sunday, but you live your life completely different the rest of the week. See, this is what God wants from you and what God wants from me. Not perfection. What God wants from us is a heart whose primary passion is to follow after God, to please God, to honor God. And that means even in the workplace, someone who is passionately trying to please God. And so as a Christian, where you live, what does it mean to have a heart that's like God's? To have a heart of integrity in the workplace? Well, it means that you think about pleasing God before you think about pleasing your boss. It means that you think about what impact my actions are going to have on my coworkers. We don't treat people unfairly just in order for us to get ahead, to get that next promotion. It means we decide to do the right thing, even if it isn't for the best interest for me at work. It means that we're honest and we're fair. It means that people in the workplace know that we're Christians and we live out our Christian faith.
We live our lives loving them and serving them, and we want to give our lives to drawing them closer to God. See, when you have a heart of integrity, then God is going to use you. He is going to make sure that you're at the center of His will and you're in the center of His plan. Now, Jesus shares this gut-wrenching truth, what happens when we put material gain or career promotion ahead of having a heart of integrity. It's found in Mark chapter 8, verse 36. Let's read that out loud, if you will, with me here this morning. Are you ready? Let's go. Mm-hmm. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? What would it profit you if you gain that promotion at work? If you gain the job that you want, but you lose your soul and you don't have integrity? Listen, do what you do well. Do what you do better than anyone else in the world, but do not lose your soul. Do not lose your integrity just to advance your career. So if you want God to please your career, if you want God to be you want to be at the center of God's plan for your career, number one, pursue a heart of integrity. And here's the second choice to conquer this giant of career success. Write this down. Trust God with my calling. Trust God with my calling. Now, calling, it is this weird word. We'll explain it in just a moment, but your calling is basically what God has created you to do. So you have to trust God with your calling, with your life's purpose, with your life's work, because He created you for it. Now, this is hard to do, isn't it? It's hard to do because we have our own ideas about what career we should have, what our future should look like, and how it is going to play out. But you see, God has His own intentions and His own plans for our future and our career. Look, David pursued God with a heart of integrity, and God called him to be king. And I want you to look, going back to that story, 1 Samuel 16, verse 12. It says this, and the Lord said, "This is the one, anoint him." So as David stood there among his brothers, Samuel took the flask of olive oil he had brought and anointed David with the oil, and the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David from that day on. Now I think we see two eternal truths in this passage. The first is this one. God sees things that we cannot see ourselves. God sees things in others that we don't see in them. But even more important than that, God sees things in us that we ourselves cannot see within us. You see, David was a shepherd boy. Why would God choose this little shepherd boy to be king? Why wouldn't He look for a warrior? Well, He had chosen a warrior to start with. He had chosen Saul, and He saw how that played out. Not very well. Did you ever think that maybe God didn't want a warrior king? Maybe God wanted a shepherd king. Maybe God wanted a king that would love His people and that would guide them and shepherd them and as a shepherd did. Maybe God saw something in David that no one else could see. And here's the second truth we find in this passage. We are happiest and we're most fulfilled when we're at the center of God's will for our life. No matter what that will is, even if it's different than what you have planned for your life. Even if it's something different than you had even began to envision. If we will trust Him with our calling, with our life as we move forward, we'll find that we're going to be the happiest. Even if He takes us on a path different than what we expect, we will be happiest if we follow His plan. Remember, God created you, and He knows the best plan for your future. Flip over your notes. Let me give you the definition for calling. My calling is where my gifts and passions intersect with God's purpose. My calling is where my gifts and passions intersect with God's purpose. See, that's your calling. It's where your gifts and your passions intersect with God's purpose. So your calling is where God takes your gifts, that the things that you are good at, and he takes your passions, the things that you that makes your heart sing, that you get excited about, and he uses them for his purposes. And his purposes means that it will always be in a way that shows his love for other people, that helps draw others closer to him. And so first you have to ask, number one, God, what is it that I'm good at? What are the gifts you have given me? What am I talented at? And then number two, ask God, what am I passionate about? What makes my heart sing? And then thirdly, how can you use these passions, these strengths, in a way that makes the biggest impact with my life for you? And here's what most of us miss. And I think not understanding the next point is the cause of so much frustration and why we're missing God's plan for what he has for our lives. Now understand this, your calling is not necessarily the same as the job, your job or your career. Your calling is not necessarily the same as your job or career. Maybe your job or career isn't your main purpose in life. You see, that's not what God intended for all of us. Have you ever thought about this? Sometimes God blesses you with a good job that just allows you to pay the bills. It allows you to pay the bills and live where you live so that you can pursue your calling outside of your job. You pursue your call. You use your gifts and your passions to pursue God's purpose within the church. So you have a job that allows you to be in the church and to use your gifts to serve in the church, or you find a community service organization, or you find another avenue. Sometimes a job is just that. It's a job. It pays the bills. But you pursue your calling outside of that. Now, you need to understand, there will never be the perfect job. Work will always be difficult, and work will never be completely fun. You see, that's why they pay you. They pay you because you probably wouldn't do this for free. You wouldn't do what you do for your job for free. That's why they pay you. That's why it's called work and not play. Now I'll tell you this, because I know a lot of people have said no to job opportunities that I really believe that God had put in front of them, but they say, well, that's not my passion. Well, that's not what I want to do for the rest of my life. That's just not exciting. I just want to do it. I don't want to do it. So they remain unemployed and they say no to the job they wanted because they say, well, that's not my passion. Well, maybe that was God providing you a way to make a living so that you could pursue your passions outside of that. Now, I met people who had jobs that paid really well and they lost those jobs. And when they start looking for new jobs, God has provided some opportunities for them, but they say no to that job because it doesn't pay as much as what they were paid before. Well, maybe you should take this job for the time being and then pursue whatever that passion is outside of that. And I just want you to see the significance here that you have a calling. For some of you, your calling is your job and it is your career, and that is great. But for a lot of people, for most people, a job is just that, a job. And then you have a calling and a passion that you can pursue outside of that. Sometimes God will provide a job that isn't your calling so that you can pursue God's call outside of that job. And that's important because it leads us to our third choice that we need to make if we want to conquer this career giant. Now I want you to write this down. Choose to do what is in front of you today and do it well. Do what is in front of you today and do it well. See, the question here is, what opportunity has God put in front of you today? Maybe it's a job you already have, and it's not ideal, and it's not your dream job. Or maybe it's a new job, but it isn't what you had hoped for. Maybe it doesn't pay as well as you had hoped for, or it's not something that you have great passion for, but maybe it's a gift from God to you. Here's why it's important that you take the opportunity that God puts in front of you and do it well. Let's go back to our story. I want you to look at David in 1 Samuel 16, verse 11. Look what it says. It says, "Then Samuel asks, talking to the father, 'Are these all the sons you have?' 'Well, they're still the youngest,' Jesse replied, 'but he's out in the fields watching the sheep and goats.'" Now, what was David doing when Samuel gets to Bethlehem? So when he comes to look for the new king, what's he doing? He's out keeping the sheep and the goats, right? That's not a romantic job. That is not the ideal job. It's not a high-level job. There's a reason why the youngest son is out doing that job, because nobody else in the family wanted it. It was seen as this menial job. And so he was doing it. He was out in the fields keeping the sheep and the goats. And I want you to get this. I don't want you to miss this. He was being faithful with the small job that he had. And because of that, God brought him something even bigger. Now, what were David's brothers doing? That's a good question, right? I mean, they were in the house. They were in the house with the father. They weren't out in the fields working the crops. They weren't keeping the goats and the sheep. They weren't in battle. What were they doing? I don't know. I mean, that's the thing. I don't know what they were doing. Maybe they thought that tending sheep was just too menial of a task for them. They're the oldest children. You see, when God looked at them, he saw something that was wrong with their hearts. Maybe this was part of their heart problem. They weren't being faithful with the small things. They weren't just waiting for something big to come along. And maybe they weren't being faithful with God, what God had already put in front of them. And maybe they had sort of just phoned it in. Have you ever done that? At work, you just sort of phoned it in. There was a task that you were given to you and you felt like it was beneath you. So you thought it was just too menial of a task. You were sort of mad that they even asked you to do it. Because do they know how long I've been here? Why would they ask me to do that? Well, I know no one in this room has ever done that, right? Nobody's ever just phoned it in. But no one's ever phoned it in and given less than your 100% on a task that you had at work. But think about it. Maybe it is a small task. Maybe it is a menial task. Maybe it's something that you shouldn't even be asked. And it makes you mad that they would ask you to do it. Maybe it makes you angry to even been asked to do something so menial. And so you just didn't give it very much effort. You didn't try. You just phoned it in. You phoned it in, but in the same time, you're hoping that you get that big promotion that they've been promising everyone. You phoned it in, but at the same time, you're hoping that God is going to give you a better job, something big in your life. But Jesus teaches us that's not how it works at all. Listen, Jesus teaches that if you're faithful in the few things, God will bless you with more. But he also teaches, if you can't be faithful with the little things, why would God trust you with something more? Why would God bring a big blessing into your life if you're not faithful in the small things that you have? In fact, Jesus tells us a parable in the book of Matthew. The parable is about a boss. He goes on a trip and he leaves the workers and he gives them some responsibilities. He doesn't leave them with these glamorous tasks. He leaves them with a small amount of money, small task. And maybe they thought the tasks were just beneath them, or they thought they were pretty menial. But he gave the three of them these tasks. And the first worker, when he comes back to see how he's done, the worker had taken that small amount of money. He probably didn't think much about it, and he buried it. He buried the money. He didn't do anything with it. The boss was so mad that he took the money away from him that he had given him. But the other two workers, they had taken what they had given, and they produced more. And the boss was happy when he came back. Look what happened. Matthew 25, verse 23. Upon returning, he says, his master replied, "Good job. You're a good and faithful servant. You proved that you could be trusted with what?
Small amount.
You proved that you can be trusted with a small amount. And now I will put you in charge of what?
A large amount.
Come and share your master's happiness. Do you see how it works in God's economy? You're faithful with a little bit first, and then he blesses you with a lot. It means when you get a little bit, you can't just shrug it off and say, that's too menial, I'm not going to do it. You're never going to get the big blessing from God. You have to be faithful with a little before he can bless you with even more. If you want something more than you have now, if you want God to bless you, be faithful in the little things. Do those things well. But many of you want to get promoted. You want a job of your dreams. You're asking God to bless you, and that's fine. But you first have to understand that God is not going to bless you with something bigger and better if you're phoning it in right now. If you're not giving your best where you are at right now. If you're not being faithful in the little things. Look, some of you have faith in God, but you lack the faithfulness to honor God in the work by doing the little things well. Be the best at the small things. Recognize how small things make a big difference and honor God. And that's the kind of life, that's the kind of career that God is going to bless. My question to you is this. What are the open doors that are in front of you right now? What are the opportunities God has given you? You say, well, that's not good enough for me. That's too menial. It's not enough. Maybe God has given it to you and telling you, be faithful in this. Do this well. I want to pour out blessings in your life, but you haven't shown me that you can be faithful with a little, so I cannot trust you with a lot. Don't get so busy on the perfect opportunity that you miss the small, important opportunity God has put in front of you right now. Look at what Ecclesiastes 9:10 says. I want us to read that verse out loud with me. Would you? We're going to begin with whatever. Are you ready? Let's go.
Whatever presents itself for you to do, do it with all your might.
Do it with all your might. Flip your notes over onto the back. To conquer the giant of career stress, whatever that might look like in your life, first, choose to pursue a heart of integrity. Second, trust God with your calling. Thirdly, do what's in front of you. Do it today and do it well. And then finally, on the back of your notes, choose this. Choose to go to work for God every day. Choose to go to work for God every day. See, now I want you, I know that some of you are in some very tough work situations right now. Maybe you're dealing with a tough boss, a boss that doesn't treat you very fairly. And I know that's tough. Maybe you're underappreciated or you're overworked. Overloaded with work, or you just don't enjoy what you're doing. You just don't enjoy it. Those are all big giants. In some workplaces, they have parties all the time. It's just fun, fun, fun. In some workplaces, they have other types of party. They have almost every day, and those are called pity parties. Have you ever had a pity party at work? You felt sorry for yourself. Oh, this isn't fair. They're dumping so much work on me. I'm kidding. I'm not getting any credit. But can you believe they thought someone else did that? You just feel sorry for ourselves. And though feeling sorry for ourselves, we begin to get resentful. We begin to get bitter. And as a result, we stop giving our best. We start phoning it in. And we phone it in, and God's blessings are removed from us. Look, if you're in a toxic work environment, that's hard. That's a hard place to be. And I'm sorry that you're in that type of place. But here's the truth. A lot of times, our biggest problem is who we are choosing to go to work for. See, the Bible gives us a novel idea over in Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. It's actually our memory verse this week. So I want us to read it out loud together. Are you ready? Let's read it. It says, in all the work you're doing, work the best you can. Work as if you're doing it for the Lord, not for people. See, that's a novel idea, isn't it? when we go to work today, say, I'm going to work for God. You're not going to work today for whatever plant, whatever job you have. You're not working for Walmart, K-Man, whoever. You're going to work today for God. And if you are a stay-at-home mom and you're going to work at home all day, you are not working just in the home, but you are working for God. You're striving to please Him. When you get up this morning, you head to work. When you head to work, you're going to work for God. Who are you trying to please? Who is your ultimate boss? The Apostle Paul said in Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, am I trying to win the approval of men or of God? And that's a great question. It's a question we should ask ourselves. Am I trying to get the approval of God or of men? Of my boss or my co-workers, or am I trying to please men? He says, if you're trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. Now, maybe you feel that what you do every day doesn't matter. That your job doesn't make an eternal significance. That you're wasting your life. But if you decide today that beginning tomorrow, when you go into work on Monday morning, that you're going to go to work for a different boss, that you're going to be, God's going to be your boss, and you're going to go to work for Him, I think you will find that there are opportunities every day in order for you to change eternity. See, if you want to please God, there are two things that you have to do with your life every day. In fact, these are the same two things that Jesus told the guy who walked up to Him and said, Jesus, what are the two most important commandments? Basically, he's saying, what is the meaning of life? And what is the most important thing in life? And Jesus answers him this way, chapter 22, verses 33 through 37. Jesus replies, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. In fact, I want you to write this to the side. I want you to write these two statements to the side. Write this. Love God, period. Love others, period. Love God, love others. Jesus was asked, what is the most important thing? And he said, love God, love others. If you want the secret to living a life that matters, love God, love others. If you want to know how to find meaning and fulfillment in a job where you right now feel stuck, love God, love others. You want to know how to bring God's blessing to your career, on your job, on your future, on your family? Love God, love others. Instead of always looking for ways to get others to serve you, instead of looking for ways to push down your coworker to get ahead, look at ways that you can love God and love others at work. Instead of always getting them to help you with your project, why don't you offer to help your coworker with their projects? Instead of pushing them down and sucking up to the boss in order to get ahead, what if you help them get ahead in their job? Instead of asking them to go get you coffee, what if you had brought coffee to someone who is lower than you on the totem pole? What if you decided that when you went to work tomorrow, you're going to love God and you're going to love others, care about them, look for ways to share your faith, and invite your coworkers to church? Begin to pray for them every day. God has them there for a reason. He has you there for a reason. And that is to love them. Look up here for a moment. You want to know what God's plan is for your career, for your job, for your future? I know exactly what it is. And I know this. His plan for you tomorrow, His plan for you every day of the week, every day of the rest of your life is this. Love God. Love others. To love God and to love others. But you say, well, Mike, today I thought, when we were talking about careers, you are going to tell me this morning what career I should take, what career path I should go down. I'm looking for some answers. I mean, should I be a doctor or a dancer? Now, hopefully that your choice this morning was more than those two. But, well, here's the answer about your career. Love God and love other people. And that's the deal. If you decide to love God and love people, then you're free to do almost anything else that you want to do. Do whatever you want. God says, as long as you love Him and love people, your individual choice of career isn't as important. I think a lot of God's will for our life is like this one lane highway, but I think it's much bigger than just one lane. I think it's this big interstate that's 8 lanes wide. And on one side, you have love God. One wall is loving God. And the other wall over here is loving others. And then you go down this line. You have these two barriers. And God doesn't want you to go past loving God outside of that or outside of loving others. You have that big 8 lanes. And you can make a choice. You can choose what you want to do. As long as you stay inside of those barriers. Loving God and loving others. There are some places I know that you can't choose some jobs, right? You can't decide, well, I think there's a great future in drug dealing. That's probably not what God wants you to do with your life, right? There are some places where you go to work. And if you choose to work there, they're going to ask you to compromise your integrity. There are some places where they're going to ask you to use people. But outside of that, there is tremendous freedom. Don't get so caught up in the idea of your career that you miss the point of your life. You were created to love God and love people. For example, careers in the Bible. Think about how many different careers. There wasn't just this one career that everyone that's a follower of God was doing this one particular thing. If we look in the Old Testament, there's all types of characters. What was Moses? Moses was a shepherd. Nimrod, he was a hunter. Nehemiah was a cupbearer of a king. Naboth was a winemaker. David was a king. We go to the New Testament. Joseph was a carpenter. Peter was a fisherman. Matthew was an IRS agent. Luke was a doctor. Paul was a tent maker. And he goes on and on, all with different careers. Look, it doesn't matter. You could be a butcher, a baker, a candlestick maker. As long as you love God and love people, you can do that. As long as you do that, do whatever else you want to do. And do it with excellence in such a way that you're working for the Lord and not for people. And if you do that, I believe God's going to bless your life. He will make sure that you make sure you're at the center of His plan for your life. Look, at whatever you're doing in life, make it a point. I'm going to love God and I'm going to love people. And when you go to work this week, work for God. Love God. Love people. And if you do that, you're going to conquer whatever that career God is that you're facing today. Will you bow your heads with me here this morning? Let's pray. Can we make this a time right now just between you and God? Maybe you this morning are facing a career giant. That giant is in front of you right now. It's causing stress. It's causing worry. It's causing fear. Will you just in your heart, in your mind, turn that over to God right now? Just pray and just right now say, God, I want you to have my career. I want you to have my job, my work, my future. I'm trusting you with that. I've been holding on to it. I've been trying to control it. I've been trying to micromanage it. But God, you created me. You see things that I cannot see. God, I want to trust you. I want to love you. And I want you to take care of me. Will you turn that over to God right now? Maybe you're facing your career giant because your heart's not right. Maybe you're like David's older brothers. There's an issue of integrity in your heart. You know it. Maybe there's a sin that you won't let go of. Maybe there's something you've been doing at work that you know is just not right because it's not what is God's best plan. God is saying, hey, you've got to get your heart right. Your heart has to be a heart that's after mine. And before I can bless you in this area, you have to search for a heart of integrity. Right now, pray. Turn your heart over to God and say, God, I'm going to get rid of the sin and I'm going to follow you. I want to be a man. I want to be a woman after your heart. Pray that right now. And maybe you're here and your job is your true calling. And your job and your strengths and your passions and God's purpose, they all intersect. If that's you, that's great. But that's not most people. Maybe your job is just that. It's just a job.
but it pays the bills and allows you to pursue God's calling in your life. Your big passion outside of work. If so, that's great. Embrace it. Maybe God is testing you today. And maybe he's saying, hey, I need you to be faithful in this. I want to bless you. I want to bring something big into your life. But you're not being faithful with the small things that I put in front of you right now. Say, okay, God, I'm going to step up. I'm going to be a woman. I'm going to be a man. I'm going to do this thing that you have put in front of me right now. I'm not going to see it as too menial. I'm not going to look at it and say it's beneath me. I'm going to do it to the best of my ability, and I'm going to see if you won't bless me with something bigger in my life. And maybe you're the only Christian in your workplace. Maybe you're it. And maybe your purpose and your calling isn't the job itself, but God has put you where you're at because of the people at right? That job. It's the people. God has you there in that workplace because you're the only Christian. You're the only way that they're ever going to find out about God. And he wants you to love on them. He wants you to let them know that you're a Christian, to help draw them closer to him. No matter who you are or what career giant you're facing, I guarantee you that God has you there right now. He has a plan for you. And trust him with your career right now. Father, take our careers, take our jobs, take our future, our work. God, we turn it all over to you. Help us to be faithful in the things, in the little things. And God, help us to go to work for you, be our boss. In everything we do, may we love you and may we love others as well. We pray all these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We come to time of decision this morning. We come every Lord's Day. We give people an opportunity to respond. And maybe there's something that you make some decisions today. Those are decisions that's between you and God. And God knows your heart. And he knows your life. And that's fine. But maybe there's some decisions that need to be made public today. Maybe the decision is that you need to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You need to repent of your sins. Confess him before men. And have your sins washed away in baptism. Maybe that's what you need to do today. Maybe there's some other decisions. Maybe there's some sin in your life that you've been trying to overcome. And you just have not been able to overcome it. And today you need some help. You need us to pray for you. You need us to hold you accountable. And maybe there's something public you need to make known. Maybe you need to make this your church home. Whatever decision, we're going to sing a song here this morning. And you have a decision to make. As we stand, as we sing, come as we sing. Come. Spaces available for that as well, and we have services this afternoon as well. So let's pray, and then we'll sing our last chorus. Most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity you give us to be in this place today. But Father, this is not the end. It's only the beginning of this week. And Father, as we walk out these doors today, that our service and living for you, we're back into the world, and help us to live for you and draw people to you. And as we do that, that you would just help us in the opportunities you give us and take up those opportunities as they arise. Father, we are so thankful for this day. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.